Good. 6 said this, your glorying is not good. Know ye not that a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump? So this is an evil kind of influence. There's also power for good in the right kind of influence. Jesus talked in Matthew chapter 5, verses 13 through 16, how those who follow him should be the salt of the earth and the light of the world. And indeed, none of us lives to himself and none dies to himself. Paul talked about this in Romans chapter 14, verse 7. The Christian uses his or her life and influence for the glory of God. Peter said in our scripture reading this morning in verse 12, having your conversation or manner of life honest among the Gentiles. It's important that he says Gentiles because as we walk among our own, among Christians, we should probably have other Christians say good things about us. But what about the Gentiles? What about those that are without? Having your conversation or manner of life honest among the Gentiles, that whereas they speak against you as evildoers, they may, by your good works, which they shall behold, glorify God in the day of visitation. So this lesson this morning will deal with four areas of our life where the Christian preaches or teaches by the life that we live. So the first point this morning, the Christian abstains from fleshly lust. Let's look again at verse 11 in 1 Peter chapter 2. And before we read this, I want to back up a little bit. In chapter 1, verse 1, I want to look at who Peter is writing to. He says, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to strangers scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. Verse 2, he says, elect according to the foreknowledge of God, the Father, through sanctification of the Spirit, unto obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ, grace unto you and peace be multiplied. He's writing to Christians, but in verse 1 he says, to strangers scattered. And then in verse 9 of chapter 2, he says, but ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and holy nation, a peculiar people. And the Greek word for peculiar here means special or unique. He's writing to Christians, but he's writing to strangers that are scattered abroad. And that's what I like about the fact that this is all about influence, because he's writing to Christians that are scattered all over Asia and all over everywhere. And that's what's important about this influence, is because it's about everything that we say and everything that we do, because he's writing to Christians that are supposed to be living their lives in a way that they're around people that don't necessarily know them. And that's the way that our lives are. We're not just always going to be around people that know us. We're going to be around people that don't know us. And we should live our lives in such a way that they see God and they see everything that we say and everything that we do. So verse 11, he says, dearly beloved, I beseech you, again, as strangers and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts, which war against the soul. So what does he mean by fleshly lust? And we've talked about this in lessons past, in the last few weeks and last few months, but lust doesn't always mean sexual desires, but any uncontrolled desire. And James describes this. If you would turn to James chapter 1. Hold your place there in 1 Peter, because we'll be back to it throughout the entire lesson. In James chapter 1, beginning in verse 12, James writes, blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him. Let no man say, when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth mortal sin, and sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. Do not err, my beloved brethren. In Peter's writings, flesh refers to human nature apart from God. It's life without the standards, help, grace, and influence of the Lord. The Christian will abstain from practices that will lead to the destruction of Christianity in one's life. We have several motives for abstaining from fleshly lusts. First, fleshly lusts, as it says in verse 11, wars against the soul. In Matthew chapter 16 and verse 26, it says, "For what profit is it to a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul?" See, we have to remember that our soul is what goes back to God. If we are obedient until death, our soul is what returns to God. I believe it was Charlie that read last week, 1 John chapter 2, verse 16, which says, "For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world." See, these are the three categories that sin falls under: the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. These are not of God. These are of the world. When we don't care about our soul, when we don't care about God, and all we care about is the lust of the flesh, we care more about the world. And our soul will return to God, but it's going to return to God on Judgment Day, and He's going to say, "Depart from me, I never knew you." And it's going to go into everlasting darkness. Our second motive is in Christ. The fact that we have staked our claim on eternity as Christians. 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 through 3 says this: "Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew Him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and doth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when He shall appear, we shall be like Him, for we shall see Him as He is. And every man that hath this hope in Him purifieth himself, even as He is pure." Since our citizenship is in heaven as Christians, we must set our minds on eternal, not on earthly things. We get this from Philippians chapter 3, 20 and 21, and also Colossians 3, 1 through 4. As Christians, our minds should always be set on heaven. Doing this will make us want to be pure because God is pure. And our third motivation, we've already looked at how to stay clean in a polluted world. If we remember Peter, he said that we must lead holy lives, and that means to be set apart by God for a sanctified purpose. 1 Peter chapter 1, 14 through 16 says, "As obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to the former lusts in your ignorance, but as He which hath called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation or life, because it is written, Be ye holy, for I am holy." Second, the Christian silently preaches or teaches good citizenship. If you would, go back to our text in 1 Peter chapter 2. We'll look at verses 13 through 17. Verses 13 through 17 says, "Submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether it be to the king as supreme, or them that are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers, and for the praise of them that do well. For so is the will of God, that with well-doing ye may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men, as free and not using your liberty for a cloak of maliciousness, but as the servants of God. Honor all, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king." Christians were often falsely accused of being lawbreakers in the first century, and even today. We'll look at today here in just a second. Acts chapter 17, verses 7 and 8. Whom Jason hath received, and these all do contrary to the decrees of Caesar, saying that there is another king, one Jesus. And they troubled the people and the rulers of the city when they heard these things. In the first century, there was a lot that were confused and thought that Jesus himself and his followers, mainly the apostles, were trying to teach that Jesus was going to be an earthly king. And were trying to go against Caesar, and that wasn't true at all. However, Paul himself tried to teach Christians the contrary. If you would turn to Romans chapter 13, we'll see what Paul taught to Christians in Rome. Romans chapter 13, beginning in verse 1. He said, "Let every soul be subject unto the higher powers, for there is no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. Whosoever resisteth the power, resisteth the ordinance of God, and they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation. For rulers are not a terror to good works, but to the evil. Wilt thou then not be afraid of the power? Do that which is good, and thou shalt have praise of the same. For he is the minister of God to thee for good. But if thou do that which is evil, be afraid, for he beareth not the sword in vain, for he is the minister of God, a revenger to execute wrath upon him that doeth evil. Wherefore ye must needs be subject, not only for wrath, but also for conscience' sake. For this cause pay ye tribute also, for they are God's ministers, attending continually upon this very thing. Render therefore to all their dues, tribute to whom tribute is due, custom to whom custom, fear to whom fear, honor to whom honor." In order to obey God, we must respect civil authority. Back in our passage, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 13, he says, "Submit yourselves to every ordinance of man." And notice the last part of there, that caveat, "for the Lord's sake." It's not for our sake, it's not for man's sake, it's for the Lord's sake. God commands it. We are to do it for the Lord's sake. Verse 15, submission to civil authority is to put to silence the ignorance of accusations, false accusations. And again, it is for the will of God. It's his will, it is his command, we are to do it. And in verse 16, we're not to use our liberty or our freedom in Christ as a license to violate man's law. Verse 16 uses this wording, at least in the King James, "not using liberty for a cloak of maliciousness." We're not to hide behind Christianity to think that we are above the law. With liberty, with freedom, there is great responsibility and accountability. And as we've discussed in lessons past, that freedom doesn't come free. Somebody had to pay for that. And in the case of Christianity, Christ paid for that freedom. And we should never take that for granted. We should never take it lightly. And as Christians, we should remember that Christ shed his blood, and we don't hold that for granted. In this country, there are some that hold our freedoms for granted. We know that there were young men and women that gave their lives. Some didn't even give their lives, but they gave their service for this country so that we could be free to do the things that we have in this country. And a lot of people take that for granted. But within Christianity, Christ gave his life when we were undeserving. And we should never take that for granted. And we should never use our freedom as a cloak. However, there is something else that we should look at. The Christian always should remember that one law is superior over another, and that is God's law, if there is a contradiction. Acts chapter 5, verse 29, and we'll look at this account in detail here in just a second. But verse 29, the apostle said we ought to obey God rather than man. When there's a clear contradiction or conflict between God's law and man's law, then we ought to obey God rather than man. If you would turn to Acts chapter 5. While you are turning there, we'll get some of the context, and we're only going to read part of this, but the high priest was mad at the apostles for preaching and teaching in the name of Jesus. The high priest had thrown the apostles in prison, and the angel had come and broken them out of prison and told them to continue to preach in Jesus' name. And they did so, and the high priest had found out about it. And in verse 26 of Acts chapter 5, we see, then went the captain with the officers and brought them without violence, for they feared the people, lest they should have been stoned. And when they had brought them, they set them before the council, and the high priest asked them, saying, did not we straitly command you that ye should not teach in this name? And behold, ye have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine and intend to bring this man's blood upon us. Then Peter and the other apostles answered and said, we ought to obey God rather than men. The God of our fathers raised up Jesus, whom ye slew and hanged on a tree. Him hath God exalted with his right hand to be a prince and a savior for to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And we are his witnesses of these things, and so is also the Holy Ghost, who God hath given to them that obey him. When they heard that, they were cut to their heart and took counsel to slay them. The apostles were good citizens. They had obeyed the law of men, but when that law had contradicted God's law, they took a stand and obeyed God's law rather than men's. And we ought to do the same. Third, the Christian's business life or work life is also a silent sermon. Back in our text, we'll look at verses 18 through 24. Servants, be subject to your masters with all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the froward. For this is thankful if a man for conscience toward God endure grief, suffering wrongfully, for what glory is it if when ye be buffeted for your faults, ye shall take it patiently, but if when ye do well and suffer for it, ye take it patiently, this is acceptable of God. For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example, that ye should follow his steps. Who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth, who when he was reviled, reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judgeth righteously, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, shall live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. For ye were as sheep going astray, but are now returned unto the shepherd and bishop of your souls. This is framed in the language of slavery, but the principles in the Old Testament call for a couple of things. First, there must be respect. The employer should show respect to the employee, and the employee should show respect to the employer. Second, there's dignity in work, and all glory is to be done to God. We've talked about work in the past. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, 31, whatsoever ye do, do all glory of God. Work is not done for an earthly master or for personal prestige or just for money, but work by the Christian is done for God. So we should let both the Christian employer and employee remember the power of godly life and influence. Remember verse 2 of our passage, having your conversation honest among the Gentiles, that whereas they speak against you as evildoers, they may by your good works, which they shall behold, glorify God in the day of visitation. I was going to share a story, but I'll save that one for another time. Fourth and finally, the power of the godly life in the home. And we'll read this one quickly. chapter 3. Likewise, you wives, be in subjection to your own husbands, that if any obey not the word, they also may without the word be won by the conversation of the wives, while they behold your chaste conversation coupled with fear, whose adorning let it not be that outward adorning of plaiting it to the hair, and of wearing of gold, or of putting on the apparel, but let it be the hidden man of the heart, and that which is not corruptible, even the ornament of a meek and quiet spirit, which is in the sight of God of great price. For after this manner in the old time, the holy women also who trusted in God adorned themselves, being in subjection unto their own husbands, even as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, whose daughters ye are, as long as ye do well and are not afraid with any amazement. Likewise, ye husbands, dwell with them according to knowledge, giving honor unto the wife as unto the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers be not hindered. Peter is acknowledging the possibility that the wife might not be able to teach the unbelieving husband by words. And there's nowhere in this text or anywhere else that the wife cannot attempt to teach by words. Now, we do have in the scriptures that women are not to usurp authority in worship, but there's nowhere that the wife can't teach the unbelieving husband at home. She can't usurp authority. But we should have our words seasoned. We should be walking the walk, talking the talk. Everything that we say and everything that we do should be a positive influence, and it should come from the Bible. Men must obey the word to be acceptable to God. Verse 1 again of chapter 3 here says, if any obey not the word, they also may without the word be won by the conversation or behavior, manner of life of the wives. 1 Peter chapter 1, beginning in verse 22, says this, seeing ye have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit unto the unfeigned love of the brethren, see that ye love one another with a pure heart fervently, being born again not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. For all flesh is as grass, and all the glory of men is the flower of grass. The grass withereth, and the flower thereof falleth away, but the word of the Lord endureth forever. And this is the word which by the gospel is preached unto you. Our actions can teach somebody if our words are not able to do so. So the wife might not be able to persuade her husband with what she says, but in this case, Peter says that her godly life might be able to do it. And this works both ways. It might be the husband that has to persuade the wife. He also talks about the wife being in subjection to the husband in verse 5. For after this manner, in the old time, the holy women also, who trusted in God, adorned themselves, being in subjection unto their own husbands. And we find out how that's supposed to be by looking at the husband's responsibility in verse 7. Likewise, ye husbands, dwell with them according to knowledge, giving honor unto the wife, as unto the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers be not hindered. So, being in subjection to the husband does not mean that the husband is to rule over with power as a dictator, but this is to be respect, honor, treat your wife with value, as she's precious. And it says heirs together. The husband is to rule as a spiritual leader, but he is not to be some all-power dictator that beats down his wife. They are to rule together and to work side by side. That's why in Genesis it says that the wife is to be a helpmate or helpmeet there too. The husband is to treat her with respect and honor as something that is precious. And so our influence at home, our influence in life, our walk and our talk should be something that comes straight from the Bible. It should be something that is positive. Again, when Jesus said that we are the salt of the earth, the light, salt keeps things from decay. Light enables us to see, but sin blurs that light, and those that we might have influenced for good might drift in spiritual darkness if that light goes out. Before I end, I want to share a story about how the writer of one of my favorite songs came up with the song. It says, on a dark and stormy night, with waves piling up like mountains on Lake Erie, a boat rocked and plunged near the Cleveland Harbor. Are we on course? Asked the captain, seeing only one beacon from the lighthouse. Quite sure, sir, replied the officer at the helm. Where are the lower lights? Gone out, sir. Can we make the harbor? We must or perish, came the reply. With a steady hand and a stalwart heart, the officer headed the ship toward the land. But in the darkness, he missed the channel, and the vessel was dashed in pieces on the rocks. Many lives were lost in a watery grave. This incident moved Philip P. Bliss to write the familiar hymn, Let the Lower Lights Be Burning. As Christians, we need to always let our positive light of Christianity be burning in this lost and dying world. To our friends, our family, and those around us who may not know us, because we can truly let the light of the gospel shine by the things that we say and the things that we do. But if we even make the simplest of mistakes, then that could be a negative impact on those around us as well. So this morning, if you are a Christian and your light has gone out, or you have lost your Savior for whatever reason, or if you are not a Christian and you need to put Christ on in baptism, or if you need the prayers of this congregation, whatever your need may be, won't you come as we stand and as we sing?
Oh, most persuaded now to believe.
Calvary, Calvary, burdens are lifted. teaching.